What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Game Over Greggy Show. I'm one of your hosts, Greg Miller. Over here, the producer slash seducer, Nick Scarpino.
Hello, Greg.
How are you?
I'm well.
We are in harmony, you and I, today.
Yes, we are.
We've been singing goofy songs about pooping and things.
I think we're through the planning phase for the most part, the bulk of E3. Now we're getting excited because we're into the fun part where we actually just go get to do it. Is that how you feel?
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This episode was recorded long before E3. We were going to play it off, sir. We were going to act like we were going to play it off. I was going to be like, man, I can't believe we got home so fast from E3 and recorded this show and had it up on patreon.com/kindoffunny.
Oh, well, then just Kevin at 158.34, bleep out everything.
That's not even, he said we were near two, and then it's like 158, whatever. Kevin out there is packing us up for.
Man, I'll tell you right now, E3 sure was fun.
Nailed it. Fucking killed it.
Thank you.
No, ladies and gentlemen, it's us. Kind of funny. Getting ready to go to E3, so we're all fucking crazy. Yeah, we had a pizza party today to raise morale, and Nick and I's morale is through the roof. Nick didn't eat the pizza.
Yeah, the pizza party was something special. I had fun.
Good. It was good. The pure one, Tim Gettys.
Yeah. I had 3 slices of pizza.
Damn. Mm-hmm. That's all? I thought you took 3 at the beginning. You never went back for seconds.
Interesting. Yeah. I was working on shit.
We've all been working on shits. But when it happens, when the pizza party pops off, you got to get on it. Mm-hmm. You can't look a pizza party horse in the mouth.
I'm happy we had a pizza party because I was promised a pizza party at IGN. Never got it.
By the way, Greg just said you can't look a pizza party horse in the mouse. So there's a new saying there. You can't look a pizza party horse in the mouse.
Earlier today, you fucked up on Colin and Greg Live, and I didn't call you.
No, I don't fuck up.
It was in the chat. I'm trying to remember what it was.
No, you'll never remember. You'll have to go watch the entire show to figure out.
Even then, I'd have to. It was the chat that called it.
Oh, I remember what it was. It was the 55-minute tirade you guys went on about backyard barbecuing. And then you drew a graph that was literally, I think, years from now, people will look at it and go, oh, that explains everything.
That was the first time we knew. The Pride of Long Island.
The first time.
Colin Moriarty was out of control.
Good to be here with you today.
They were geniuses as well.
But they were twisted geniuses.
Twisted fucks.
I was just examining the barbecue situation, that's all.
I feel like we are losing our grip on reality quicker.
Oh, definitely. I haven't even left the house in 3 days. I was just done.
That's fine. I'll probably do it.
Yeah, I haven't left the house at all since Sunday.
You don't need to.
It's Wednesday.
You got drones. We'll drone airdrop you shit.
What? Went to the grocery store. Got everything I needed. Got the internet.
We're set.
You got a toilet. You got 55 to 65 half-drunk bottles of Arrowhead water. Mm-hmm. You're good to go.
Oh, I'm fantastic.
This is not going to go bad.
No, definitely not.
Water. Definitely. How many times have you refilled that particular bottle? Do you know?
Like 4 times, probably. Okay. Yeah. That's looking like
nailed
about
it. It was Celtic. It said Celtic, like a Celtic warrior, and you kept saying Celtic, idiot.
We say Celtic in the United States.
No, we don't.
Yeah, we do. What is the Boston basketball team called, Greg? I'm just curious.
The Celtics?
They're the Celtics.
Okay, good. Okay, I was just curious. Just curious about, you know, that, you know, about the only usage of a word in American English is the basketball team that we've been calling the Celtics for like 120 years.
Amy Gilroy fell off her pot of gold over in Ireland and couldn't believe her fucking ears.
Was she a leprechaun?
I don't know what to tell you about that.
I'm just letting you know. You screwed up.
I'm half Irish.
Too.
I didn't screw anything up. We don't. This is the thing that bothers me. Is we do not say words the way that they're said in their native languages. English is an amalgamation of a lot of different words. A lot of them come from. Many of them come from Latin. You don't see us speaking fucking Latin over here. We Americanize your words.
Yeah, we slaughter it.
I don't roll my R's.
Yeah, I don't say churro.
Say ruffles.
Ruffles.
Yeah, you don't. You're right. Good call.
You know, it's the niche and niche is the great word.
Yeah,
it is niche. It's niche. The word is niche. There's no accent aigu over it.
That's so it's
niche. If we're talking about the salad.
So in French, it would be niche.
Or nicoise.
You know,
nichey.
But in English, in American English, it's niche.
It's true.
We if don't you just, didn't know,
no, I'm not
this
done.
Is
I'm not
the
done.
Game Over Greggy show.
No, you can keep going.
Oh, Greg, thank you. Going. Now rub a little bit. There it is. Each and every week, four is some. Oh, yeah, right there. Each and every week, four.
Is your pee-pee getting hard?
Best friends gather on this table. Not yet.
Is your pish getting hard?
No, my pish isn't getting hard.
What do you guys call it?
Magic fingers.
What's the new word? The
pish leak.
No, pish leak.
The pish leak.
Yeah, I like that.
Why? Yeah, what's the leak added into it?
My grandmother would just randomly throw in extra vowels at the end of everything.
She sounds like
it's like how everyone would say, oh, you want some. That's a good example is my Italian family, you know, being like, oh, you got, you know, we have some, you know, spaghetti, we got, you know, pasta, so prosciutto. I'm like, it's prosciutto. And they're like, oh, it's and like, oh, you want some mozzarella? I'm like, it's mozzarella.
That's
it's
just your mozzarella. Mom. Isn't that your mom?
My whole Italian side of my family does that. It's a good example. It's like, we've been here since 1920.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can call it a pee-pee. We don't say that anymore.
Yeah.
Stop asking me if my pish is clean. I'm 30 years old.
Yeah. My mom says she has a few of those parlance sayings left. She says agita all the time.
Oh, agita is a great word. I use that word a lot.
Which one does that mean?
It just
means stomach indigestion.
Stomach indigestion. Okay. She's like, but she uses it to for just a total different, like, she'll use it for just a myriad of reasons. Like, you'll piss her off. She'll be like,
"Are you giving me ajuda?"
She'll be like, "Oh, you give me the ajuda, or you're upsetting my ajuda, or my ajuda doesn't like that, or hey, you and my ajuda should go fuck off."
Whoa,
I made that last seems one drastic. Up, but that, I mean, I wouldn't put that past my mom. She's very flowery when she gets angry.
Coolie
with her language, the coolie. Nikki, that was my grandmother would always say, "Nikki, did you wash your coolie? Did you watch all the Kiki out of your coolie?" And I'm like, "Grandmother, I'm 17 years old. Yes. I have if I haven't figured out how to wash my ass at this point, it's never going to happen. You don't have to worry about it.
Kiki out of the coolie. The good Kiki. Lord.
You poop out of your butt."
Yep.
Each bring a random topic of discussion for your amusement. If you like that, you can go to patreon.com/kindoffunny each and every Friday to get the show a whole week early. If you don't have any money to give us, no big deal. Go to youtube.com/kindoffunny day by day, topic by topic. It's broken out for your amusement for nothing. Then on Friday, we put the whole show up for free as a video and an MP3.
Thrizzle.
Tim.
Shalik.
You begin.
Oh, I begin.
You like that?
Damn.
We didn't go over an order. I want to toss it right to you.
I didn't know.
Get going. Do your thing.
All right. My topic today is going to be, what is your favorite Disney movie?
Mm.
Now, the reason this comes up is I saw this really, really cool picture on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
It's this thing you might have heard of. There's remember the Disney movies of the 90s when they released the VHSs and they came in those big ass
puffy
VHS cases. It was like only Disney did it, but then sometimes like things.
I hated those things with a passion.
They threw off your whole
threw off the aesthetic of my VHS tape collection.
And no, as you guys all know, I hate that. Like, I want my collection to be a damn collection, but what I did like is that they standardized it. So at least all your animated films, your collection of those would be that.
Like, you couldn't do it alphabetically. You had to do it by genre. And so you'd have like the Star Wars movies and then the Disney animated films that were like this big and then back to the regular size VHSs. It was rubbish.
Yeah, but they deserved to get
a lot of marketing.
I had Ghostbusters 1 and 2 on VHS in those same puffy cases.
Well, yeah, so I feel like they revolutionized and then a bunch of other motherfuckers started copying them.
That's when you knew you had like a film.
Yeah.
You didn't have a movie you were picking up from Blockbuster. Mm-hmm. You had a fucking piece of art right there.
Yeah, exactly.
That needed to be protected.
And then there was like Balto and all those like knockoff ass animated films.
Where do you stand on, because I had a couple, because we forgot to take them back, of the ones that open up like this. Not the puffy cases, but the actual like VHS rental cases that you like and open them up. I loved those. I thought that's
how. Blockbuster case.
Yeah, but Blockbuster would take, eventually just print it out like the name of the movie on it and when they give it to you. Back in the day, you used to go to, I used to go to Video Wiz, and they would actually have the cover on it, which would be cool. So you'd get it, and it would be by the 15th or 16th time you got it, or like someone rented it, it was like chewed up and looked like someone's dog had eaten it.
Yeah,
but it was awesome. And then they figured it out that they could just like sell.
Video stores, how weird was
that? Yeah, man.
Yeah, they're awesome.
Yeah, you just don't think about it anymore.
I know.
I would spend so much time just going to Blockbuster or I forget what the other one was called near my house, but like
Video Villa. That was
it. Wasn't
one.
Video. There was a Hollywood. There was a Hollywood Video. I never fucked with Hollywood Video.
By the time they came around, I was like, I'm Blockbuster. Ride or die. Yeah. I'm not fucking around here.
Yeah, but there was the little like mom and pop ones.
Yeah,
like there was a couple of those, and I liked those a lot. And those are the ones that had the porn in the back. And being a little kid, I was like,
I see some titties.
Yeah,
but
Yeah, you casually walk by like you're like pretending like you're a 7-year old pretending like you're interested in French New Wave cinema because it was always that, and then right behind the doors was the porn. You're like, oh, Godard, I should check this out.
You're jacking off in the back of Video Villa.
Why not?
Do what you got to do.
Anyways, we're way off topic.
Okay, going back to the topic. So I saw an image on the internet of someone made a Frozen VHS in that style.
That's cool.
And I was like, that's fucking cool. And it's like something that I never would have thought about just because like those things have been out of my mind for surprisingly long for me being me. So that made me start thinking about the collection. I started talking to a couple of my friends just about what their thoughts are on different Disney movies because depending on when you were born, like you stopped watching them at different times, you know? So I feel like I have fonder memories of, say, Hercules or Pocahontas. In like Tarzan era than you guys would.
One of those movies was good.
Okay. Pocahontas?
Pocahontas, yeah.
Okay. Well, see, Pocahontas is the one that we decided is kind of the teetering point of the – it is the end of the Golden Age.
It is.
But it doesn't necessarily qualify as Golden Age.
No, definitely doesn't.
No, I would say it does.
Golden Age ended, I think, with Lion King.
Pocahontas was the – oh, wait.
I'm breaking out a list of Disney movies.
We did one movie too many. Like, that was – because, I mean, Pocahontas was huge, man. It's like Mel Gibson. Didn't he do the voice of the main
John
character?
John Smith.
John Smith. And then who was the – who actually played Pocahontas, do we know?
No idea.
Anyway, I just remember that movie being huge and then seeing it and going, Like, it just was missing the mat. Like, The Lion King still, you watch that to this day,
yeah,
is a piece of art. It is so beautifully done. And then you go back and watch Pocahontas. And then the other day, I literally, it was like 6 months ago, I watched Hercules because it's on Netflix. And I was like, oh, I've never seen this. And then I watched the first 10 minutes and I'm like, oh, no, I have seen this. I couldn't get through the first 10 minutes and I still can't get through it. I had to put it down. I was like, I can't stand this movie.
Yeah, Hercules is weird. I remember seeing that.
I love it, but it's different. But so the Golden Age, we got Little Mermaid, Aladdin.
The Lion King.
No, wait. Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, and then Lion King.
Was Little Mermaid before Beauty and the Beast?
Yes.
It was.
Okay. Little Mermaid was 89.
Okay. Yep. And November 17th, 1989.
Yeah. So then those four are like the undeniable Golden Age.
Right.
Then there's, you get
there,
into...
There's some in there too. Rescuers, isn't there? That would be in the Golden Age.
According to this,
you think that counts as Golden Age?
Yeah, I love Rescuers.
Well, I mean, if we're going back... So starting with Lion King and then going backwards in time, they have it as Lion King, Nightmare Before Christmas, Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast, The Rescuers Down Under, DuckTales the Movie, The Little Mermaid, Oliver and Company, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, The Great Mouse Detective, The Black Cauldron, The Fox and the Hound, The Rescuers, The Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh.
And now we're getting into it.
Now we're in the 70s.
Now we're getting into the good stuff.
The good stuff. Yeah, so there's a lot of stuff. Then obviously there's the original shit back in the day. We got the Snow White, Cinderella's, Sleeping Beauties,
into and all those. That. The only one that really stands out for me was the when they did Robin Hood. And I remember watching Robin Hood, and I was in Italy, and it was one of those trips where I was too young to really be going around Italy for like 3 weeks with my parents and my brother. So I was so fucking bored, and I had zero interest in anything other than watching movies and eating at the time. So I had half that covered in Italy because the food's amazing. But I remember going over to one of our cousins' houses in Rome. And sitting down and having them go, hey, we've got this. And it was the American version of Robin Hood and did the Disney movie.
Yeah.
And I was like, pop that in right now. And I watched it like 3 times.
Well, that's what I was going to say was, yeah, the music's awesome in it. Robin Hood's my favorite Disney movie.
Really?
Like, definitively.
Yeah, it's
my
great.
Top three is Robin Hood, Peter Pan, and Fox and the Hound in that order. Robin Hood's early 50s, or Peter Pan's early 50s, Robin Hood's 70s, Fox and the Hound's early 80s. And I think those capture the essence of
what era would that be called then? If
well, that's what I'm saying. Like, to me, that is the golden era. Like, I feel like Little Mermaid and Rescuers brought it back for me when I was a young kid.
I never saw Rescuers.
89 and
Rescuers
like 91.
Rescuers is fucking awesome.
But the original Rescuers is in the early 80s.
Like, golden era, I think, really is just those four movies.
Depends on your age, though, because, like, you know, an animation nerd like my brother loves those movies, but is much more impressed with the generally older, probably animators and stuff would be much more impressed with something like Fox and the Hound or something like that. So I think it is something that is in up to your interpretation. I feel like that was when Little Mermaid specifically was when Disney movies became very, very, very big. Very, very big. And that was the first one I remember seeing in the theater, too. It came out in 89. I was like 5 or 6. And I love The Little Mermaid. I remember getting the tape that you're talking about. I remember that very well. And I liked Lion King. I wasn't a huge fan of Aladdin. And
really?
Then,
so Aladdin's my favorite.
Yeah. I love that movie. It's a good movie, but I was okay. I was like, it's fine.
I have no modern love for the Disney movies. I don't look back and think of them nostalgically or anything like that. But I think Aladdin is the one I remember I got and watched a lot. Watched it over and over again. And then right behind that was Little Mermaid. And then the rest I didn't give a fuck about.
Now, not even Lion King?
Nope. Lion King especially did not work for me.
No way.
I was just too old for it. I had grown up.
Oh, man.
I had seen Superman comics. I had things to do.
That's crazy.
Not see these fucking kittens rolling around, spelling out sex in the dust.
You wanted to be more in reality, like rooted in reality.
I wanted to see some people who could fly and shoot beams from their eyes.
Yeah, that makes sense.
The crazy thing to me is, as I'm looking at this list, the list becomes so bulbous and full of whatever the fuck it is at, you know, by the 2000s. There's so many fucking movies, man.
When you look at these lists, though, they count a lot of the straight to... VHS, sure. Or straight to DVD, or straight to Blu-ray.
Or the sequels, whatever. Which you like,
Aladdin
3,
Jafar in his glasses.
No, Aladdin 3, King of the Thieves, or something like that. So good. It was good. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you. There are certain Disney sequels that get shat on, and they shouldn't. Little Mermaid 2 does not deserve hate.
What
it
is
really
it even
doesn't.
About? Give me the plot line. What happens to Sebastian?
Daughter,
I just want to
like
know what happens to Sebastian.
He's
the
dead.
Daughter of Ariel and the Prince?
Mm-hmm.
What, she got to go back to the water?
Yeah, it's kind of the opposite story.
She wants to live under the sea.
Yes.
That seems like an easy sell for Sebastian.
So,
is he dead? Is he alive?
Sebastian is definitely not dead. But
Sebastian's the crab, right?
He's awesome. Under
Aladdin
the sea.
2 and 3 are awesome. Lion King 2, awesome. Pretty much any of the other sequels,
the Revenge
I can't.
Of Timon
like, Bambi
and Pimba.
2, not good. Little Mermaid 3, fucking atrocious.
Yeah, I mean, you really don't want to include any of the sequels when you're talking about Disney movies. Just because I think largely...
See, I don't think that's true.
I think largely they didn't put the resources, the heart into those that they did into the originals. And so, I mean, you can keep them in consideration, but no one's going to the original Little Mermaid's going to be way better than any sequels, anything else that came out afterward.
I mean, yeah, the resources were totally different. Like, the animation's garbage, comparatively. Because it was, like, the TV animated series team working on it. Which, by the way, shout out to the fucking animated series of Aladdin and Hercules and Little Mermaid. They're all good.
They're all great. We're not criticizing them. They have way more limited resources and way quicker timetables they have to work with than an animated movie.
What's the read on Hunchback of Notre Dame? Was that a good one?
So that also counts into the, depending on your age. Like, that was the first one, I think, that I didn't see in theaters.
Okay.
Like, there was that, there's Lilo and Stitch, there's Atlantis.
A Bug's Life.
See, that's Pixar, though.
It's all on the list.
So can we, as I was going to ask, can we count the Pixar movies?
I wouldn't, like, Pixar Tarzan. Is its own thing.
Can we count Avengers?
No.
Star Wars?
Mm-mm.
I'm gonna say this real quick.
Is Batman here anywhere?
I'm looking at the list. The last of these movies, literally, and this is including all of Disney's movies, like Disney animated movies, including Pixar's movies. The last one I saw it all the way through, and I saw it in there, was Mulan. That was in 1998.
And then there's Mulan, which is fucking awesome.
Oh, I actually really liked Mulan a lot. And I saw it in the theater in Philadelphia with my brother. I don't remember
liking it.
Mulan's great.
But there's like so many. Garbage. There's a Bambi 2. Yeah, how the fuck is there a Bambi 2? It doesn't even make any sense.
No, anyone Thumper's backstory?
Yeah, it was genius. It was actually a prequel. Bambi's mom loses her mom. Oh. Finds love.
It's like Fuller House. Up.
Exactly like Fuller House. It's Fuller House.
There's so
Fuller
many. Bambi. Like, I can't. I don't even know what. Like, some of these might even be fake movies. Like, The Secret World of Arrietty. Arrietty? I've never heard of that in my life.
I think that's a...
Wait, that's a Japanese thing. Isn't that a Franken Japanese anime Ween? Film?
This is all just in a Disney... Maybe these are just Disney
published.
Have,
but I think Disney this may have Disney put them
anime,
out.
Like, yeah, it's, Disney that's animated Ghibli films.
Stuff, right?
Yeah, The Secret...
Ponyo?
Arrietty is...
That's Ghibli.
Those might
Ratatouille,
have been,
that was a legitimate anime movie.
That was Pixar.
But those might have been put out by like subsidiaries of Disney. Like, I think...
Well, I mean, yeah, Disney owns all these motherfuckers.
I've never even heard of any of these movies.
Does Disney own Studio Ghibli?
Yeah. Well, I mean, they released their Blu-rays, so.
Oh, that makes sense. They might not own them. They probably have a distribution, right? Yeah.
But, I mean, there's Disney logos all over.
Let me tell you about Studio Ghibli, brother.
Yeah, they do that. I would not be surprised if they bought
Monsters, Inc. is that old, huh?
Studio Ghibli's amazing. By the way, have you guys watched that documentary about them? I think I brought it up before. It's on Netflix. It's genius. It's called The House of Dreams and Madness, and it's about Miyazaki doing his last film. And it's amazing. I mean, they still, it's like a tiny little studio that they built from the ground up, three stories, and he just has a little corner, and like he does all of his storyboarding. Like he writes the script as storyboard, so he doesn't write a script. He just like actually draws as he's going to write. Mm-hmm. So it takes him forever to do this stuff. But it's cool to watch like how they do all the ADR and all that stuff for animated stuff. It's really worth the watch. And plus, that team is just genius. The Studio Ghibli guys, they're so incredibly talented. It's sad.
Jesus. Yeah, I remember. You know, I watched a lot of anime with my brother when I was a kid, and I remember, you know, we've talked about before watching Bubblegum Crisis or Ranma Half or whatever, and they were fun and they were good. But I remember Mononoke being the first thing I'd ever seen, except for maybe Ranma, where, and obviously Akira. But other than those, like where I was like, this is insane. Like I remember seeing Mononoke and being like, this is absurd how good this is and like how beautiful it is. And obviously I was a fan ever since, and it was so cool to see them cross over to level 5 to do Ni No Kuni, because that was fucking awesome. Like that they did a video game. Yeah. And it was gorgeous and it was fun. You know. Really a lot of talent.
You would get a kick out of this documentary then. Cause really it's like it just shows how they do it, and it's such a painstaking process to hand animate things, and they still hand animate everything, and they'll show the guys doing the background boards in like watercolor, and you're like, is that real? And then they take a picture of it, and that's just the frame of the background for the movie, and you're like, that's fucking insane, man. They don't go back in and I'm sure they retouched it a little bit here and there. Mm-hmm. But it's pretty talented. But that's what Colin was saying, to bring it back to the Disney topic, which is that I think too many, it depends on who you ask. If you ask a 40-year-old or a 50-year-old what was the golden era of Disney, they would say, oh, it's got to be Snow White, it's got to be
Cinderella.
When Walt
was bouncing around.
Yeah, like when they first popularized the release of the animated film, that's probably when a lot of people would think about it. But I agree that like right around The Little Mermaid is when they brought storytelling up into the modern era, where you know, up until then you're like, I don't know what's going on here, but that had a lot of humor and a lot of depth and was not particularly aimed toward kids, and it was still a play on, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's still a play on the storyline is actually taken from not mythology.
I mean, almost all are.
Yeah, all of them are. They're not original like stories, fairy tales, right? Yeah, except maybe for the Lion King, but I'm sure that's based on something
Lion King?
Too.
Are you joking?
What's that?
Hamlet?
Is it Hamlet?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, so there he's thinking of the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Original IP from Disney.
Yeah, no, I'm pretty sure like every Disney movie's taken, it's just a retelling of some story.
Dull Shakespeare.
Yes.
Diane.
Yes.
I didn't realize, I didn't put that together, two and two, that it was Hamlet. I didn't know that. That's funny.
Oh, I thought you were.
That makes total sense. I didn't realize that.
Yeah. What's your favorite, Greg? Which one did you say?
I said Aladdin's number one, because I remember distinctly getting Aladdin for Christmas and watching it nonstop while playing on my Sega Game Gear Jeopardy.
Oh, okay.
Had a Jeopardy on the Sega Game
Gear. How'd you fare on that?
I was fucking kicking its ass. Now, granted, not that many questions. So after a while, you pretty much know everything. You're going for the perfect game, Alex.
Why do you call me Alex? I'm not Alex.
Like Trebek. Alex Trebek.
No, but you looked at me and you were like, you were like in that space again when you were a kid. Yeah. You just zoned out for a second. You scare me sometimes. You terrify me. Mm-hmm.
I feel like if you Google Disney Golden Age, like people, that's a thing that I feel like they'd be referring
a lot of
bad
DeviantArt, I bet too.
There'd be some good stuff, but it would be the early '90s movies, and I think that's just because it was like a back-to-back successes.
Everything that was coming out was awesome, like Pixar.
Yeah,
like they were coming out
way quicker. You have to understand that from Snow White kind of era, and even before that, obviously Fantasia and all that, through Fox and the Hound and up until Little Mermaid, they were releasing a movie like every few years of that. So
it was
like they really ramped up, I think, and started funding more movies. Where like between Mermaid, Rescuers, Aladdin, Lion King, Pocahontas, all came out within like 10 years of each other.
I mean, they were essentially annualizing. Yeah. Like movies, and they became event movies and all that stuff. And they had a system where they would release the VHS, and it would be the half year, and then the vault and all this shit.
So they knew
what the fuck they were doing.
But then what happened is
Toy Story came out, and it started this CG thing with Pixar, and they were competing. And that is when I think people started losing interest in the classic Disney animated movies, because then that's when we started seeing the Mulan and Lilo and Stitch and Atlantis and that type of stuff. And then that's way later.
Okay.
And that actually kind of bring back like the Renaissance.
That revitalized.
Emperor's New Groove.
Yeah.
So a lot of,
Emperor's New Groove.
It's mixed a little bit, but people refer to that period that you're talking about as the Renaissance.
The Renaissance.
Not the Golden Era. The Golden Era is when they actually like popularized it with Steamboat Willie and going all the way up to the release. But a lot of people say the 89, like starting around 80, the late 80s is the Renaissance, when they had a renaissance of coming up
actual
and creating amazing
stuff.
Shit.
Yeah, because then they made Chicken Little, which was like a CG, like
isn't that stop motion?
It was Disney's first CG, like fully CG movie, and it was fucking trash, and that like ruined them. And then they put out a bunch of things that were no good, like Brother Bear and On the Run or some shit like that. I don't know. There was a bunch of stuff that was really bad.
Right.
And then Princess and the Frog came out, and that kind of like revitalized, and that brought it back to the hand-drawn animation that I don't think we're ever really going to see again, because that was a success, but not a big enough success.
To justify the time.
Whatever. And then you see things like Frozen, and you're just like, all right, well,
it's funny too, with the hand-drawn animation is really expensive now too. It's funny that like doing a movie like Toy Story, they're still very expensive to do, but that was like enormously expensive, and the story behind Pixar and all that is fascinating. But that was like really extraordinarily expensive, but now you're seeing like it's being like transposed now, where we were talking about this with Ego with pixel art and Bloodstain and Castlevania stuff, where it's just way cheaper not to do like hand animations and hand drawn stuff anymore, unfortunately. So
because technology just kind of reached that point where it's like it's easier to just 3D model things and just animate them as they go instead of having to hand draw every single frame.
Pixel. Right. But I still like the look, like Mermaid, I'm not sure, probably, but certainly in the 90s, like all of those were computer assisted. So that's why I like the look of something like Fox and the Hound. I think Fox and the Hound's fucking gorgeous. Or Robin Hood. Those are hand animated and actually just hand animated, and then filmed. Like in some, you probably know more about it than I do.
Just take a picture of it.
Yeah. And you can see how crude it is and how I love it. I love watching the animations, and there's like flubs and fucked up things in it, and it just keeps going, as opposed to these more computer assisted kind of things that are pretty and are still hand drawn, like Mermaid was, but it was computer assisted. It's like the way my brother animates now, where he draws everything by hand, but it's on a computer, as opposed to
doing
the way
paper and flipping.
Yeah, you've seen that with everything though. Like I just started watching Attack on Titan, right? And you're seeing that a lot of their coloring and a lot of their lines are very, very digitally drawn. They're still drawn, they're still hand drawn, but it doesn't have that squiggly look that a traditional hand drawn line would draw.
I mean, we're gone from that. We've been away from that for a while.
It's a shame though, because I feel like that's why Robin Hood, Peter Pan, and Fox and the Hound are my favorites, because they have that essence and that spirit
yeah.
of what it was to make an animated movie. And how, I'm not saying it's easy to make that stuff now. It's certainly not easy, but how fucking grueling it must have been to make those movies. And why? And that's why it took them forever to make them.
It's funny too, though, because when you look at that, like, there's so many like things on the internet about this now, but they would just like essentially copy and paste techniques over all those old movies. Like, they would reuse animations all the time. Oh, so it's funny.
That was what's hilarious in the 80s. It was so popular when you'd watch an 80s cartoon show series and you'd be like, you don't really realize it, so you watch it when you're an adult, and you're like, holy shit, that same explosion or that same like airplane going down.
It's like the Wilhelm scream. Once you see it, you can't unsee
it. Yeah, you can't unsee it. But yeah, they had to. They had to do that.
But there's dance scenes in like Snow White and Robin Hood and all that, and they're like literally the exact same.
Yeah,
exact same thing.
Yeah, there's a YouTube video on that, I think I saw that.
And there's a whole bunch of it like throughout those old movies. And I love stuff like that. Like, it's interesting to me. And then it's funny because I have a different approach where like I love Aladdin so much because I loved the super clean, like, HD look of how the drawings look because it was computer assisted. And you can see the difference between, like, Aladdin 1 and Aladdin 2 and 3 because those were a little more cheaply done. And it's like, man, quality animation is a fucking beautiful thing. And that's why something like Princess and the Frog is gorgeous to look at because it's, like, it's just perfected. It's using computers and stuff. But, yeah, I hope we see more of that, but I don't think we ever will.
No. It's over. Computers have won. Colin.
Yes.
I say we back the order. You're next.
Thank you. You don't even know what I'm going to say today. I won't even ask. It's going to be fun.
I'm sure it's something about...
reptiles.
Columns.
Space.
Columns, like the architectural columns.
You tell me what it's about.
What's a game? Buttress?
No, it's not the game.
What's a buttress? About? A flying buttress is the...
the arches.
Like the arches arch. That's like when they started building up, they needed to build these things. Like, it's very gothic. They would build these things that would support the structure.
Mm-hmm. Imagine so that piece of foam being a support structure.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Buttress.
Okay. So we touched on this when we were in Atlanta, and I was actually talking to Cheryl about it a little bit.
Your girlfriend.
What is the best region or country for food? Like, if you were going to eat. In other words, is, like, French food the best, or is Japanese food the best, or whatever?
And are we allowed to say American?
Yeah, we are. And so here's what I'm going to say. If you remove all of the culinary pretension about the way we eat in the United States... Mm-hmm. I would say that Southern food in the United States is the best food there is. And then if you go into the Deep South, if you go to Georgia, you go to the Carolinas, you go to Texas, whatever, Alabama, that they eat better. And I'm not saying healthier, I'm saying they eat better.
So, yeah, okay, I'll go ahead. Sorry.
And their food is better, and that definitively Southern American food, not South American, but Southern United States, Southern American food is the best.
So you're saying the best tasting food.
Yep.
Okay.
So, like,
no
what, in
repercussions
other words,
of gravy?
No. Who cares about that?
Like, I'm just making sure I got the criteria
of
right. Gravy.
The culinary. It's just about like the culinary tradition of a certain place.
Sure.
So you might like French food. I love Italian food, for instance, or anything like that. I love obviously food from New York, but I'm saying overall, you have barbecue, you have ribs and chicken, and you have brisket. You have beef. You have mac and cheese. You have potato salad.
Corn
you have baked beans. You have cornbread. You have you know coleslaw. You have all you know. You have
everything.
Gravy fries. You have all like. It's perfect.
Mm-hmm. They also do other food right. Like, they do burgers.
Yeah.
Nice. Because they just have burgers. They're like, would you like mac and cheese on it? Yeah, I would. Would you like all those other things you just named on it? Yeah.
Yeah,
sure.
Sure,
why not? Tater tots?
Tater tots, pulled pork. All, like, they just, it just is nailed. I mean, usually I go to a restaurant, I look at a menu, and I'm like, okay, I like these few things, and then I pick from one. When we go to a place like Vortex in Atlanta, I'm looking at the menu for literally 20 minutes. Yeah. I'm like, I have no idea what I want, because I want
you want everything.
It.
Yeah.
And so I would say, it's not pretentious food at all. No one pretends that it's high.
It's blue collar.
It's very blue collar, but it's fucking good. And I told Cheryl, I was like, I would take a rack of ribs or a brisket or something any day of the week over a Michelin star restaurant. Like that. Like good. If someone's like, hey, you can either have a Michelin star meal. You're not going to pay for it. You can either have a Michelin star meal of whatever, or you can have the best barbecue in Tennessee. You know, I'll be like, I'll take the best barbecue in Tennessee. Thanks.
And really, the best barbecue in Tennessee is just some place to put up a sign that said best barbecue in Tennessee.
For sure.
Because everyone else has it, too.
Absolutely.
But still, they're all fucking good.
You know what I mean? Like, so...
No,
like,
I'm with you.
Yeah. I mean, so that's... I'm curious about what you guys think about that.
Do you think... You're putting the barbecue on a pedestal. You're putting the Southern food on a pedestal. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's because it's impossible to replicate anywhere else? So many places. In San Francisco, even, like, oh, Southern food here. And you go there and it's good, but it's not as good as any hole in the wall you'd throw a rock at and hit in Atlanta.
There's something about that. It's the same way I feel about pizza and bagels in New York, where like people are like, oh, we have New York style pizza. I'm like, no, you don't. And we have good New York bagels. I'm like, no, you don't. You don't have New York bagels. But it's not that they're not trying. It's that it just seems like it's not possible.
Sure.
You know, to do it. It's the same thing with Chinese food. Like, you know, Szechuan versus, you know, the way they make it here, like Hunan, kind of more Chinese food, as I understand the differentiation between them. So there is something to be said about that. There are some good barbecue places here, but they are not on the level of a hole in the wall that I've been to in North Carolina or a hole in the wall I've been to, you know, in the Deep South, even in Virginia. You know, they just have a tradition of eating in these states that is just next level. And I was talking to my, you know, Eric Castro, who's a friend of the show, does Follow the Leader with us, and he was in Tennessee for a week. And he's like, the thing about eating down here is that they just really don't care. And it's not in a bad way. It's in a good way, where they're like, this is our tradition. This is how we eat. And you want your shakes and your smoothies, and you can go back to San Francisco, you can go to New York. Like, we don't eat that down here, you know? Mm-hmm. And I appreciate and love that. We saw it when we were in Atlanta. Yeah. It's out of fucking control down there.
Yeah.
And yeah. I'd be fucked seven ways from Sunday if I lived down there. It would just be over.
It's gluttonous.
Yeah.
Like, it's just ridiculous. You see that shit and you just want it all, and then you want to go again and again and again because it's fucking good.
It's perfect.
Like, the only thing that scares me about choosing that area as my spot is that means no burritos. Because, man, burritos are such a good thing. California burritos, like, we're spoiled. Like, we've spent a significant amount of time in California. We know what a burrito is, what a burrito should be. And burritos are just so good.
Yeah, burritos are on point here.
Pizza is one of those things, like, we always talk about this, pizza, burritos. These are the perfect foods. But it's like, burritos, we know what good ones are, and we have them all the time.
Pizza, you can't go back.
Yeah, pizza, I think, is one of those things where it's like, and maybe it's just because I don't have that same connection as you do to, like, a New York pizza. To me, pizza is fucking pizza. Like, even pizza is pizza. Like, good pizza is good pizza, and I will give the credit to it. But, I mean, even bad pizza, I'm like, oh, this is still pizza. Bad burrito, I don't want it.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like, I think that's the differentiation there. But, man, the Southern food, there's so much. There's so much different stuff. And really, it all comes down to just stuff that tastes good and meat.
Yeah, it's just
and it's sauces.
It's just the barbecue sauces and the mac and cheese and the it's like the fuck.
They really do not shy away from sugar or cheese
or butter
and that's got to give that.
God
to
bless them.
I came back from Atlanta and I'm like, I don't need to eat for a good 2-3 weeks. Of course, I did. Of course, the next day I got a burrito. Because to Tim's point, I think that's my litmus. That's my sort of like test as to whether or not an area is habitable. Is can I get a good burrito? Now, I like the burritos up here, but my problem is that not a lot of places are open late enough up here for me to get a burrito.
Big problem.
And so I always sort of default to Southern California, where you can, if you're willing to drive an extra 5 minutes out of your way before you're coming home, you can get an all night, like, you get a great carne asada burrito at like 2 o'clock in the morning if you want. No problem. I know like 3 or 4 places that you can find those. And most likely they're going to be packed at that time because they're known for that sort of thing. I hate the fact that when I come home late, or we came home from Atlanta, and I was like, I just really want a burrito. But I came home and it was like 11 o'clock after I dropped everyone off. And I was like, really, my only choice right now is really bad pizza.
Yeah.
And when I say bad pizza, I don't mean like the place was bad all the time. It's just at 11 o'clock, they're doing the thing where they're like, oh, yeah, I don't know. We got whatever you want. And then you look over and they have 3 slices of cheese pizza left, and they just put some toppings on it and throw it in the, like, reheat it in the oven. Yeah. And you're like, oh, Jesus. And it tastes like stale Parmesan cheese. So I'm not really into that.
San Francisco doesn't have a good night culture, like late night culture.
It's not because there isn't not,
The food is just.
Well, no, they don't have a good late night culture for the bars because the bars close so early. So there's no late night food culture because no one's out late.
That's true.
Yeah. There was one, shining, like, lighthouse in my neighborhood for a few minutes. And that was this place called Taco. Was it Taco? No, it was Toma, T-O-M-A, which for a while the owner was like, yeah, we're going to be staying open until 3 o'clock in the morning on Fridays and Saturdays. So you could go and get a freshly made burrito after the bars. And I was like,
this was that is the little jam. Place?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I love that so much. They don't do it anymore?
No. What they started doing was, because it was too expensive to keep it open, they weren't making enough money, is they started pre-making the burritos and then, like, wrapping them and keeping on the grill hot so you could get, like, you only had, like, 3 choices. It was either chicken, vegetarian, or, like, carne asada. But when you'd get it, you'd open it up, and it would be like an overpopped bag of popcorn. You would just go open it up and go, pow! And then you'd look at it. Everything would be like dry and super crispy.
No. Here's the thing.
It was not good.
It was amazing. Those things are awesome.
Like, they were better than pizza, but it, you should have seen them when you could get them freshly made.
Okay, yeah, that's the thing. I missed out on this freshly made. That sounds like magic. But what this is, it's a grab-and-go burrito when you want it most. Oh,
it was pretty okay. It was okay.
But freshness, Tim.
I love. But my thing is, like,
yeah, but I'm not looking for freshness at 2 a.m. Like, I'm looking for a burrito, Greg.
Well, here's what I'm saying. There's a chain restaurant in Southern California called it's always some combination of Birdo's or Alejandro's or Rigoberto's. Mm. There are these restaurants that you can buy in their franchises. And if you go, they're open. I think they're open 24/7. And you can go. There's one in Newport Beach specifically that we used to go to after UC Irvine. And so we'd go, instead of going to Denny's, we're like, who wants burritos? Great. We go back to someone's house and kill them. But these burritos, the tortilla started this big. We kill the burritos.
Thank you.
I thought you were saying,
who the wants guy burritos? Else, wants I do.
And then he bring back to the fucking place kill them.
You're like the Manson family.
All right, that one.
That's not how this got to. But they'd start with the tortilla that was like this big.
Yeah.
And then they put it down. If you ordered a carne asada burrito, they would just put carne asada in it and a little bit of guacamole, pico de gallo. And like, if you wanted salsa, they could be like, they'd look at you kind of weird. And when they were done rolling it, it would be the size of Greg's arm. And you would just, and it was so salty and so fresh and so good. You would just destroy it.
In Columbia, there's an institution in Columbia, Missouri called El Rancho. And that's the thing. Like, they're right on the main strip on Broadway, right next to all the bars. And they stay open and fucking make money hand over fist. Yeah,
they're just crushing.
And it's because everyone there is some college student who's wasted who wants Mexican food, nachos or whatever.
I just feel like there's something about Southern food, though, where it actually brings like a tear to my eye, where I'm like, you motherfuckers are going to serve me a cheeseburger, and instead of putting it on buns, you're going to put it on two grilled cheese sandwiches. Is that what you're saying to me right now? And they're like, yes, that's exactly what we're saying to you. And I'm like, you guys are fucking fantastic.
Yeah.
Why don't we do that anywhere else?
And then they see the gravy on your plate, and they walk by, and they're just like, you're not going to finish that gravy.
It's like, the gravy into your mouth.
How am I supposed to finish it? And like, and just walk away. It's like, damn,
man. It's on point.
But I get you. You're right.
See, I think it's fun for one or two meals, but the person, the little fat kid inside me that struggles with his weight still is like, don't, you can't eat like that forever. There's just a guilt that comes along with that, that I just don't get with a burrito, because a burrito is seemingly a finite thing, whereas in the Southern food, you're just like, they'll just keep bringing you calories. And I don't mean food, I mean just like those fries we had probably had 4,000 calories in them.
Oh, no doubt about it.
And
I was
that
gonna
is
say
not like when you compare that to what you're getting, the calories to the taste. Yes, it's equal, but for how long? How long are you willing to do that until you have to actually buy new jeans and go, what the shit am I doing with my life? I was like sweating when I was eating those things. And there was some sort of mystical power that menu at Vortex had over me, that every single thing comes with tater tots, and I just could not say no. She was like, there comes with tater tots. You want tater tots? I'm like, yes, I will have tater tots. And can you bring me a side of it? And then Greg orders a fucking side of tater tots with cheese dip.
Because I had to. Dude. That's the whole thing, though. But that's the whole thing. Ugh. Is that this whole trip was, you had to.
Yeah.
We had to live this way. We had to eat as much of this as possible. And I think that
they let you smoke inside. That was the other thing.
God bless them.
There's this honeymoon syndrome, I think, down there. And I think it's the fact that you're just not, it's not available to you. There's no real, we can go to Hard Water, we can go to Hard Knocks. These places are great and we love the food, but it's not the same as being there, right? And having amazing fried chicken and having like a fucking everything.
My mouth has watered maybe 10 times during this topic. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good lord. I'm hungry. Those tots, those fries.
I mean, that's the thing. Is there another section of the United States or country you want to argue? Well, no one's gonna argue. I love Japan, I love sushi, and I love ramen,
but that's not the answer.
No, I mean, yeah, I
shout out to sushi and ramen,
just shout out to Japan.
Shout out to Japan.
I love Japan.
I agree.
Back to Japan.
Hey,
Japan,
if you're watching,
that's the thing I think that is the salient point here is that, yeah, I like eating in Japan too. I like the barbecue, I like the ramen, all
Yeah, yeah.
And I like going, I grew up Italian, I like Italian food. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of Italian food I don't like.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of Japanese food I don't like.
Sure.
Really tell me of a legitimate Southern food except for like pig's feet or something like that where I'm like, I won't eat that.
But you would try.
I might. Because here's the thing
honey, you like all our other food? Try these pig's feet.
That's the thing is that
they've been running through your mind all day. I'll be right back.
There comes a point where you have to acknowledge that they've really never steered me wrong in the South. I spent a lot of time down there. And, like, a lot of time. An inordinate amount of time for someone from the North. Because a lot of my family's moved down there. I've spent just a lot of time in North Carolina and Virginia and, et cetera and so on. And they just don't steer you wrong.
Yeah.
It just isn't really happening there. On an Italian, I went to an Italian place in Napa, great Italian place with Cheryl this last weekend. It was fantastic.
What was it called?
Papa Americano.
What was it called? Bistro Don something.
Mm.
I don't know. It was very good. Really, Don Julio, yeah. Served a lot of tequila.
Don Julio's.
But I looked at the menu, and there was a few things on there that I really liked, but there was a lot of things on there I didn't like, and sure. I grew up Italian. And we always talk about the, you know, Christmas Eve tradition of the seven fishes and stuff like that, where I wanted to fucking kill myself. So there's a lot of Italian food, even as much as I'm ride or die with Italian food, that I wouldn't eat.
Sure.
And even in North, you know, like a lot of Northern food, even with bagels, like putting lox and salmon on bagels and stuff like that, and cream cheese, I'm like, no, like that's too much for me. And that's a very New York thing to do. Very New York.
I love lox on a bagel.
So yeah, it's too. Like, yeah, like I like the bagels with butter on them or like an egg sandwich, but you're putting like,
oh no,
you're getting a little fucking crazy with
when you put salmon. Here's what you got to do. Okay.
You can talk about
here's what you got to do. You got to go to a good bagel place. This House of Bagels you guys have got over here, it's not bad.
Yeah, House of Bagels is probably that's in the Richmond, and that's probably the best bagel in San Francisco.
Now, one block from where I grew up.
You get the New York style bagel. Don't puss out and get the 3 ounces of lox. Get the 6 ounces of lox. Make sure. And what I like what they do is they put the capers on. They put the cream cheese on, then capers.
Capers are great.
Then the onions. Capers.
Then they'll put the tomato. Then they put the lox on top of it, like it's like a organic saran wrap that locks everything in. So when you take a bite, all the shit doesn't just fall apart. I don't like it when they stack it on the lox and all you're left with is lox and a smell on your hand that you can't get rid of. It smells like.
What is
high school?
Oh, dear.
Damn!
That's awful.
That was a nice save, and I really liked it because it was good.
It was getting bad.
It was real good.
It was getting real bad. What the hell are we talking about?
You're talking about how you are gross and eat capers.
I love capers. Gross. Love them, man. They just add a little ping to everything.
Little boogers.
So are we definitively saying then that
California's the best? Yeah.
No, I'm saying no offense to California because I do believe that the burrito game here is on point. You can't get good burritos in New York. Yeah. It's just not. But Mexican food in New York is just not good. I agree, and I agree that the burritos get better the further down you go.
Oh, yeah.
San Diego, I think, still... As for the burritos, I like the San Diego, like, where they really put fucking french fries in your shit and stuff like that. I like that kind of burrito.
All the times I've gone to Comic-Con, I've never gotten out to the San Diego burrito places. I remember when I first... And I'm sorry to sidetrack real quick, but to give San Diego a tip of the hat, I remember when Arthur would go down for trips at IGN and come back with a suitcase full of burritos that he would give out to people. And I it was just like, that's weird.
That's weird.
I would not have eaten that suitcase.
Yeah, that's Anthony Gaius has no problem eating suitcase burritos.
But I'm going to say California's cuisine game, there's little micro, like, locate, like Napa and Sonoma have really fucking good food. You know, I think that San Diego actually has really good food. But I don't think California's food game is really world class at all. You know, I think I think that there's like good things there. The burrito is American. You know, Tex-Mex or the Mexican food that we really eat, it really is American. So like where, how do you associate that and where do you associate that with or whatever, as opposed to something like Southern food, like basically anything that was in the Confederacy can be identified as places that made this shit up.
Yeah.
And they do it the best. And then obviously you have New York and you have Boston with clam chowder, whatever, but I just feel like for a whole menu full of food, it's the South.
See, you know, I disagree. I like variety. I'll take variety over. Like I would rather have a variety of options versus one really good option, and I feel like that's what you get. Well, granted, in the South's defense, we chose to go to the same restaurant like 9 times. All we did was eat a Chick-fil-A and Vortex. So I'm sure that there's other types of food that we could have indulged.
It's a metropolitan place.
Really, really good. But I'm just so used to California, and that's the thing. When you travel to Europe, you're like, oh, I'm in Italy. I'm gonna eat Italian food all day long. Over and over and over again. Same with Germany. We're like, I'm going to eat more sausages. This is great. Oh, an Italian place. I'll eat there because I need a break. Here, you've just got so much more variety, I feel like. And that's why I just like living in California. I love that. I don't think I could deal with fried chicken all the time. It just would drive me nuts. I'd be sweating grease.
Sure. That's why it's nice to look through this world where, you know, you look through the glass. We don't live over there.
Yeah, it's nice.
We used to go to the vacation and do all these things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Southern food's pretty fucking amazing.
Yeah.
Tim, do you have anything?
I mean, I fucked up at Vortex the first time we went, and I got the like Hell's Fury burger or whatever, because I've been on this kick recently where I realized that I actually like jalapeno peppers.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been like getting burgers with it and stuff, and I'm in love with it. So there, I was like, I'm gonna do this. Little did I know that they do things right there. So
yeah, you got the habanero sauce, not the jalapeno sauce.
I know. Thought I could take it.
That was the issue.
And you I were couldn't
sweating.
Bro. I was dying. I was not in a good place, and it sucked.
Yep.
Did that ruin my meal?
No.
Oh, God, no. Oh, because I still had tater tots.
Yeah,
I still had those fries. I still had the biggest Coke in the goddamn world.
Oh, yeah. That was and the you'd best.
You'd be fucking damned if she didn't refill it before it was finished, even though she didn't need to.
I love when they do
Like, good
that.
Lord. It was just,
service was good there.
Everything also, about that was special.
It
but
was just
like,
a great experience, too, because we had those two TVs, right? Where Colin could watch sports and I could watch the
Scorpion King. Wrong side.
And it was amazing.
But it was special to me because, Colin said this earlier, there wasn't a thing on that menu that didn't make my dick hard. Mm-hmm. I'm going there, guys.
Yeah. I don't remember him saying that earlier, but I think you're paraphrasing.
Yeah, I'm paraphrasing just a bit. But like, man, it was just hard the entire time. And then I got the one thing that, you know, gave it maybe a little bit of doubt.
Yeah,
it popped down, but it went right back up when I had a tot.
Yeah, the tots were good. And the.
I feel like even nominating anything else is insulting the self because it's so good. And I do put it on that pedestal as well. I'm so good. Getting excited just to go to MomoCon to eat the food.
Yeah.
Who the fuck cares who I'm going to see? That? I'm kidding.
I missed a burrito, though. Like, I can't not say that I wanted a burrito so bad.
But that's the whole thing. Is like, where my head's going with this, if we're talking about regions of food, is Chicago food, which is, you know, a Chicago hot dog, an Italian beef, you know, stuffed pizza, you know, the Chicago-style pizza. And, like, I miss that, though. It's the same thing. I miss that. That's the thing. You know what I mean? When I'm in there... When I'm in Chicago for a week, I eventually stop going to Portillo's every day. It takes me a long time, but it eventually happens.
Yeah.
If I'm there for 3 days, I'm there five times. It's that simple.
It happens.
Portillo's is on point, though.
It is.
And that's the thing, too. Just
ruthlessly on point.
Of, like, Chicago, what Chicago does right? It's like,
ruthlessly on point.
When I talk about Portillo's and I talk about how much I love Portillo's, so many Chicagoans get mad. Like, what about Gene and Jude's? What about Wiener Circle? What about, like, they name a million other places that have...
What was that middle one? Gin and Juice?
Gene and Jude's. It's another hot dog.
I always caught up on the Wiener Circle.
What about Al's Big Beef? I mean, like,
Al's
all these,
Big Beef.
Like, I'm talking, like, it's like, this is the land of a million different places that fucking wrap an Italian beef with fucking French fries and give it to you. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, my God. I'll tell you, dude, when I went to Portillo's with you the first time, I was like, it's going to be good. I know that's going to be good. Great. Yeah. It's good culinary taste. But that's one of the few places I've ever gone where I'm like, I'm getting that meal again right now. And I went back up. Because I remember getting two hot dogs and fries and a Coke. And I went back up and got two more hot dogs, another fry, and another Coke.
Where do you put it?
In my gut.
The elliptical.
It was so good. And there was a fucking really funny picture because Naomi was there with us and a few other people. And there's an awesome picture of someone took of me where it's like just a picture of her. And I'm in the background just like shoving a fucking hot dog in my mouth. And like the Coke's in my, like I'm already like preemptively bringing the Coke up and stuff like that.
I'm hoping to get there.
Gold.
I'm hoping to get there in the past for you, ladies and gentlemen, on Saturday at E3 or 43. Even Sunday before E3. Get another zip car shoot down there.
That would be maybe. I wonder what time I get in that day.
On Sunday?
Yeah, maybe I can join you.
That'd be awesome. Really, but you have to get in early. I doubt you're gonna get in early enough to do that.
Let me see.
We'll be there.
Okay, let's go. You wanna go Sunday?
Fuck me.
Or
hey, what do you want me to do? You booked your own flight.
Do you need to be there? Because I'm going to go on Saturday night. I got a thing that I got to do in Riverside. I can come back through Buena Park.
Pick up
food for everyone.
I like where your head's at.
We have to buy it for my brother, though.
Okay.
Because he's driving.
I get in.
Maybe Sunday we can take Colin back down, too. Who cares? Mm-hmm. We have some fun.
All right.
What is the time?
What?
Oh, I get in at like 11:30.
That's not terrible.
I could be to the hotel probably by 1. We can go and then come back for Bethesda.
We got to take a look. I might need you guys for rehearsal. We'll have to figure out the schedule. I might need you guys for.
All right, we can do that off. We can do that off the.
We also have Friday. That I don't think we leave till late.
No, we don't have Friday.
Oh,
we're doing,
that's right.
We're doing Connery right. Live at Attack, and I think he wants to maybe do shows with us there.
All right,
damn me it. At least. Maybe not you.
James. Yeah, not yeah, no.
Nobody
fuck
wants
us.
To see you guys. All right, my time. 2:22. It's weird when Kevin's got to go pack stuff. I got to take time codes again.
Kevin's actually doing
it's
a great
like
job.
It's like it's Game
Over
Show 13 again.
Wait a minute. Stop.
Yeah.
Here's the ironic thing about this. Kevin Pereira wants to do something with Greg, and none of us.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we're real sad, whatever. And then we just go to Portillo's.
Yeah.
Greg. And then we don't get you anything.
I'm going to get you a shake and then pour it out on the ground and pee on it.
Damn, that's hard. I'm going to go with you on Sunday.
Ultimate retribution.
I was the one who turned it around. I'm going to go with you on Sunday.
Ultimate retribution.
My topic.
I want to meet Kevin Pereira.
You're going to meet him.
You're still coming. A couple times. Yeah,
all right, everybody.
Don't look at Kevin Pereira.
My topic is simple.
Am I allowed to look him in the eyes?
Yeah, of course. He loves that.
Don't look at him.
When you meet him, immediately look him in the eyes and caress his face.
Do you think people...
If Nick's in jail by the time you hear this, that's why.
Maybe.
My topic. My topic is I want to talk about the basically daily things you hate. And I pitched as the chores you hate. Mm. And I thought about this because I just got a haircut. And I fucking hate getting a haircut.
Oh, lordy lord, me
it's
too.
It's just like there's so many dumb things that eat up time. Mm. What's going on? What's happening?
You're getting really gray.
Oh, I know. You're stressing me the fuck out. It's killing me being with you. You're sapping my youth.
All right, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry. I thought my wife was in the room for a second.
No, yeah, no, I'm going gray. Yeah. Gray. It's funny because, like, Greg's going gray. I'd already been getting gray. And I remember at IGN, I'd come home and I'd feel like I'd have this headache in my temples from this, like, all the stupid stuff we're doing and thinking about this, just being stressed out, right? And I'd be like, oh, I'm graying quicker in my temples. I'm like, God, thank God when we leave. We're out on our own. I bet that stress goes away. And it's 1,000 times worse.
Yeah.
It's all over the place. But I don't care. I embrace it. I want cool gray hair.
Why does you have a great head of hair?
Yeah.
Why does the haircut stress you out?
It doesn't stress me out. I just hate it.
Why?
It's a pain in the ass.
Why?
I gotta take time out of my day to go down and do this.
I've noticed something about you. Yeah, go ahead. You don't pamper yourself enough. You don't reward yourself enough for all the hard work.
I think I do. I just reward myself in a much different way than you and your climbing community.
By
eating what I want to eat, playing games all day long.
It's different in the climbing community. As Tim knows now, he is an official member of the climbing community.
Yeah, I'm officially inducted into the community.
Tim,
I've climbed. I got 15 feet off the floor.
The thing is, when you're 16 feet above the rest of the world, Greg, you don't need to pamper yourself because the wind of God is pampering you.
I was going to say, you open a Cliff Bar up there and you just enjoy the view.
It's just amazing.
Yeah.
You drink Dasani water.
Yeah.
You snap into a organic ostrich Slim Jim.
I was going to say, I knew it was looking like a Slim Jim once you said snap into it. No, the problem is our days are so busy that I had such a pain in the ass.
So, like, I'm going to get my haircut tonight, right, for E3.
Oh, yeah. Fuck. When am I going to get a haircut before you?
You look perfect. You look perfect. You don't need a haircut.
No, I do.
You look on point.
Hold on.
You're on fleek.
Keep the top, though.
Thank you. I know. That's what I need to do. And I've been doing that recently. I'm just like, give me just one on the sides. I want to keep the motherfucking top. Do you understand that? Keep the top.
And Kevin's like, yeah, I got it.
They didn't fucking do it. And I'm like, you motherfuckers. It was when we launched this goddamn company.
The original Channing Tatum. It was ridiculous.
Mm.
The step up.
Guys, go back and look at like around January 5th when we like launched the show.
Is it the video where we all like announced that?
Yeah, the video of us on White. Any content around there, I'm like, you fucking assholes ruined me. Mm-hmm. But whatever. I came back.
You bounced back, and you got great hair. And that's the thing with you, Greg, is that, yes, you are rewarding yourself in that you are allowing yourself to have some free time. But you need to just allow yourself to go have that one thing that's away from this world. And to me, that is the haircut. You sit. They massage the scalp. You relax. Someone pampers you. They ask you what you want. If they screw up, you just make them do it more. Like, you know, you make them fix whatever they have to fix. And – I don't know. It's one of the only times I have in my life where I actually do something like that. And occasionally my wife will buy me like a massage or something. And that's why I feel really pampered. But something with you is you got to slow down a little bit.
No, I got to get it done. My whole life is weighing and deciding what to do with these things. It's all arithmetic, as the great Arnold Einstein once said. It's all arithmetic in the way of
Einstein.
Whatever.
Is that Albert's cousin?
Exactly. He was
a butcher shop.
He was a barber.
Lifted weights a lot.
And he lifted weights and he was part of the climbing community. It's all about, like, if I spend 30 minutes, an hour getting a haircut, that's 30 minutes, an hour that puts me behind on work, that puts me away from video games, that puts me with other chores. I hate coming home and having more chores to do. That's why I started shipping out the laundry. And then I started getting groceries mailed into me too, where I would just fucking do it online and they'd get them delivered. And it was great. And then I got cancer. And Christine blamed all the fucking terrible old food we ate. So we had to go do this and start shopping and fucking walking around. Hate it. Hate everything.
Yeah.
Haircuts, man. I'm like, I'm with you on this. It's like, I don't like it. I get what you're saying about the whole pampering. I don't like the pampering. It's like, I don't want you touching me. I don't want this to be happening right now.
I had a head massage during a thing. And it was another thing where I was getting my haircut. I was super stressed out. This is back at IGN when I took time out of the day to go do it. Mm-hmm. And I was already mad and all this other stuff. And the lady's like, do you want me to massage your head? And I was like, yeah. And then she broke out like a belt sander and just put it on. And it was like this thing all over my fucking head. And I almost cried. It felt so good. Because it was such a stress relief. It was so good. I was like, holy
shit. That's so funny. See, I just don't like that. I don't like massages. I don't like things like that. I hate when they start doing all that stuff. I don't even like when they like wash my hair. I'm like, I got this.
Yeah.
You don't need to do this. And as you guys know, you all know when it's Tim's haircut day. Because I'll come in looking like a damn. What do I look like?
You look like you woke up at an 11-year-old boy's slumber party.
Oh.
But I was also
not
11.
Like, yeah, you're 11 too. Yeah. Not like you're creepy. Yeah. Like, not like you come out and it's like, is that glazed like, donut stuff all over your face? And you're like, don't worry about it. No, God. I mean, guys, your hair is all puffy and you,
yeah.
You every day asks, walk into like a GQ model. I was with you last night. No, you look like the guy. Remember that episode of Seinfeld with the soft water?
Yeah.
That's low flow?
It was low flow where like all the hair was just kind of like.
Yeah.
That's what he looks like.
Yeah. Here, install your new low flow shower head.
Here's the thing about haircuts.
Yeah.
Is that I don't really give a fuck. I just want the hair off my head, and I don't care what it looks like. So I bought a buzzer for $20 like 8 years ago, and I have not paid for a haircut since, and I just sit in the bathroom and go like this.
I miss those days.
And then Cheryl comes in and like helps me out. I'm like, oh, you missed a piece of hair here. Yeah, you have to do my neck. And I'm like, does it look good? She's like, I guess. And I'm like, that's good enough.
But yeah. Your hair, you can't do anything with you.
No, I can't. But like, I don't get, like, people I know, like, and I used to do it when I was younger, like get their head shaved like every 2 weeks and like get cut up and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. I'm like, lined I don't up. Care. There's sometimes just a stray hair I didn't get, and I noticed it like 3 weeks later. I'm like, who cares? You know, at some point, I just don't give a fuck anymore. The thing I dread doing is working out. I hate it. I fucking hate it. I hate doing it. And it's a waste of my time, but I have to do it or I'm going to feel bad about myself. And that's the only reason I do it every day. I hate doing it. I fucking hate it. There's people like, oh, you're going to love it. You're going to love run. It was the same thing when I used to run when I was younger. Oh, you're going to love running. You're going to look forward
get
to
that running.
I never once in my fucking life looked forward to running.
You're going
to
have more energy.
Ever.
No.
And now that I have this elliptical for the last year and a half, they're like, oh, you're gonna look forward to using it. I use it. I was telling Charlie, I probably used that elliptical 400 times since I've had it.
Yeah.
And because I usually go 5-6 days a week. And I'm like, I've never once been like, oh, now is the time I'm going to go on the now. Usually I'm like, fuck, I usually look at the clock and I'm like, all right, a half an hour from now is this time and I'll be done by then. All right, let's go. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's the thing I look for every day that I that I don't look forward to. But the haircut thing, it's just, I just have to get in there. This is the thing is that Greg made me feel like I was becoming such a skinhead with the way I was shaving my head.
You're going
my head
like, way too close.
Well, now the swastika was a step too far.
You but I shaved my head again. Like that for many years. And the only reason I did it was because it gave me more time until I had to do it again.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That was saving me precious weeks, if not a month or more. As opposed to, I just cut my hair a few days ago, and this is as long as it is now. And that's so. This is like month two.
But everyone keeps complimenting how good you look. So it's also the beard.
Thank you.
You finally look good. Damn. You don't look like a monster. It's hard to do that, though. Of us, and you look terrible.
I respect
that. You look like you were going to stab Eric Jensen and then murder me, too.
That's not nice.
I'm just letting you know so you never do it again.
I'm not a terrible-looking person.
No, not usually, except when you look like that.
I'll out-handsome you, Greg. I'll out handsome you damn. Any day of the week. Mm. Try me, motherfucker.
I'm already
challenged.
Laughing at it. Don't worry about it.
Hair, man. It's hard.
I thought you had. I'm sorry. I thought we were.
Just thinking, I mean, for me, Tim Gettys, you guys know me well, right?
Yeah.
I don't like doing anything. I am a lazy motherfucker when it comes to doing pretty much anything I don't want to do.
Yeah.
How are those taxes going, by the way?
Oh, my God. What are they done?
Just fuck with
yeah. No, I just hate doing stuff. I hate doing things.
Period. You
not
hate
a big
things,
fan of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, especially things that don't make any fucking sense, like taxes and like
adult stuff in general. Yeah. I hate
any
that
of that shit.
Yeah,
being an adult, hell no. That's what I have Kevin for.
My health insurance is still all fucked up. I'll fix it eventually.
What's fucked up about it?
We'll explain off the air.
Okay.
But I got a call from my doctor for, hey, you have an appointment tomorrow, which I totally forgot about. And this is like 3 weeks ago. You have an appointment tomorrow. I'm like, oh. And like, have you changed your insurance? I'm like, not since last time. And they're like, well, that's weird. We called and they said you don't have insurance. I was like, well, I need to look into that. So a week later, I called them and I got something. It's a long story. But
do you have insurance?
I hate
that.
Fuck I have that. It kind of. We'll talk about it later.
Okay. That's all so shitty.
You're paying for it.
So and I hate having to plan to do like doctor stuff. Or any adult stuff, really. Anything that's not just, I'm going to wake up and do my normal life the way that I want to live my life. I ain't into this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, having to do any chore. So pretty much, we call it, me and Kevin's girlfriend, we have this thing, and we call it a Kevin plan. And a Kevin plan is, I'm going to cram
fall down and knock
10
over.
Fucking thousand things into 1 hour from point A to point B. There's going to be a point for every letter of the alphabet. There's going to be a couple Russian letters in there, and there's going to be umlauts. Umlaut? Yeah, we're getting some umlauts.
Okay.
Like, all this shit's going on. We're not just going to go drive you home, Tim. Oh, no, no, no. No, no, no. We're going to pick this person up, drop them off here, go pick up my mom's freaking dry cleaning. Oh, but by the way, she didn't get this dry clean, so we're going to go to Macy's and buy a new shirt, but then we're going to bring it to the gas station because I need to get gas. We're going to ask the gas station attendant what they think about the shirt, and if they don't like it, we're going to try to return it to Target. That doesn't even make sense. But they're going to do all this shit,
mm-hmm.
and then we just end up, and I'm just like, I hate all of this. No. Oh, of course it's not over, Kevin. Kevin's here saying no. You're right. No, because we have to go take a trip to the dump, and Tim has to do fucking physical labor. Tim needs to fucking pick up these goddamn dressers that I already had to go fucking buy from Costco a year before for his damn mom, because his mom needs to buy a fucking shit ton of dressers. Then we go to the goddamn dump, and Kevin's like, hey, Tim, I need you to pick this up. I'm like, Kevin, I'm trying my hardest, man, and it's just bad. I fucking hate you, Kevin.
Mm. I was going to say, it sounds like you hate Kevin, not even just his chores.
Yeah. Do you know how many times I got phone calls? And this is how Kevin plans start. Hey Tim, hey, do you wanna go get some Signore's pizza?
No, it's coffee.
For lunch? Yeah, I do. Definitely. Okay, cool. I'll be at your house in 5 minutes. He gets to my house. Hey, we're doing a lot of other things today. We're gonna go. Because he knows how to get me.
Yeah,
it's pizza. Fucking, yeah.
I appreciate that though, because that reminds me a great deal of myself in the sense that there comes a day of the week usually, and Greg knows it well, where I'm just like. Everything I need to that needs to get done has to happen right now. And then I'll put the laundry in, then I'll come back and write a bunch of emails and get dinner going and all these kinds of things, run to get the dry cleaning. I got to go to the bank. I got to mail this thing. And I kind of try to see – Mike Mitchell used to comment on it where I was like, how quickly can I possibly get all this done so I could just never think about it again? And so I appreciate that because I have – usually Saturday is that for me where I'm like, I got to do all these things. My obsession is getting my laundry time down as low as possible, and I actually keep track of it in my head. Mm-hmm. And I've gotten it down, getting the laundry from the front door back into the front door. I've done it in a little over an hour. You need 24 minutes for the washer, 35 minutes or so for the dryer. But I go and cheat a little bit.
You know? You go there, oh, the dryer is not done. You're like, fuck.
Usually
this time this shit.
Usually I look at it. There's like 7 minutes left. I'm like, I'm still under an hour in my time or whatever. And I'm like, I'm taking everything out. And I just start, and like the towels are still wet, but everything else is dry. I'm like, fuck it, I don't care. I gotta get the fuck out of here.
This will air out on its own.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna get them wet again. What do I care?
Cheryl makes fun of me for, I'm obsessed with multitasking to this point where she's like, you're not saving any time. You're actually spending more time doing this. And I'm like, no, I feel better doing this. So this is what I'm gonna do. That's why I wash dishes as I cook and stuff like that. She's like, you're taking a longer time. And I'm like, no, I have to do it this way because then there's no dishes to wash later.
Yeah,
you understand what I'm saying? You understand? Do you get it? And she doesn't.
No.
That's but fine. I appreciate you, Kevin. I appreciate that go-getterness. I don't appreciate you tricking your friends into helping you do it. I do it all by myself.
I only tricked him.
A schemer gets schemed is what they say.
He does only trick me. Yeah. And God damn. And the thing is, it's like, it's always when I least want to do it, which to be fair is always. But I have to do it because I'm like, this motherfucker helps me do literally everything. Like, there'll be times when I'm like, I can't get into my shirt. Can you please hold it for me? And without even hesitation, he already has my shirt ready, my socks ready, my shoes ready. This motherfucker just has my life on lock, and I appreciate that. Mm-hmm.
He's like your odd job.
Yes, he really is. I just hate physical labor. That would be my answer. Physical labor of any type.
So, like, I feel like if it wasn't already in use and ready for E3, we'd break out the big whiteboard right now. Because what I want is the order of operations.
Break out the whiteboard.
On how this all goes in terms of the helping tree. Because I always saw you and Alfredo, and then you bolstering Alfredo, it seemed like. Because that guy is all beauty and no brains.
Yes,
like,
he's just beautiful.
I mean, the fucking body on him, right? Mm-hmm. But upstairs, nothing.
Nothing.
So, but then you were the man behind him.
Yes.
So then the man behind you is Kevin.
Yes.
Wait, what was Tim doing behind him? How close were they together?
We're doing a lot of things.
Can we have a real Rob Rush conversation?
I'm sorry.
A real Rob Rush conversation? Is that what you said?
Who's behind Kevin? Or is Kevin just...
Who's Rob Rush?
No, it's a circular thing. But then...
Oh, it's circular.
Very circular when you're talking about Kevin. But with Kevin specifically, like
he's fat.
Kevin was behind the me and Alfredo thing too. Any Tim and Alfredo video...
Well, the owner of operations there, he's behind. Yeah.
But I mean, what I'm saying is like people think, oh, Tim and Alfredo, but it's just like... Kevin was the one shooting and doing audio and doing everything for those videos.
But the question, let me distill this,
yes,
because I think I understand what you're saying. Behind every great Alfredo is a great Tim.
Yes.
Behind every great Tim is a great Kevin.
Yes.
Behind every great Kevin is...
A taqueria.
There you go.
Yeah. Nailed it. That might be the answer.
Kevin loves food. Like 12 times
a day. Greg's drawing a diagram.
And sex. Food and sex.
What?
That's what Alfredo drives you.
Is that Tim?
Yes.
What is...
Is that someone person's mouth a vagina?
In Kevin's?
So as you see here, we have Kevin with the beard.
Mm-hmm.
No hair, though.
Then you have Tim with the hair.
Yeah.
And then you got Fredo with the muscles.
Oh.
So like that.
Either muscles or he's got something weird going on.
Yeah.
His nether region, his penis.
Those are abs. You want to know what they look like?
No idea.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's definitely, it's a team team job. I'm the brains of it, and I don't like doing anything physical. And it's really unfortunate that I'm the brains, because I don't got much of those either. But
you got a lot of brains.
I'm really good at using my brain in one very specific way.
Scheming.
That's it. I can make thumbnails pretty damn good.
Yeah, he can.
Yeah.
That you can.
That's all I got.
I love that Nick had on the edge of his tongue taqueria when I asked what behind every great Kevin is a taqueria.
I mean, it's true. Like, that's what Kevin's always trying to get you to go eat burritos.
Lisa's taqueria.
Kevin's always like this.
Closed never invites me.
He's always like this. He just whispers over. He's like,
not today.
We trying to get some burritos right now?
Next week. Or what? After
we're trying to get some
but that answer was right so now? Rapid that it was like, behind every great Kevin is taqueria. Before I even finish saying it.
Nick, what chores, what do you hate? What
thing? All the stuff I used to hate that you guys are talking about, with the exception of haircuts, that's just crazy talk. I didn't used to like physical labor. My brother beat that out of me a long time ago because he used to make me help him, and my life depended on it, literally, because I didn't have any money. So he's like, you got to come help me. This is the only paying gig you have, and it involves lifting a shit ton of scenery into a truck, driving through LA traffic at 5 o'clock on a Friday, and then unloading it onto an LA street when everyone's trying to get around you, and then coming back and doing the reverse of that 2 days later. And I would dread it. I would like not be able to get go to sleep at night because I'd be dreading having to wake up in the morning. And I think that's probably the only thing that I have left from the era of me being quasi lazy is I hate going to sleep because I hate waking up. I don't like getting out of bed. And so I prolong the experience of staying up late to the point where last night I was like, I'm so tired. I can't even focus on Attack on Titan, but I bet if I ate some rice pudding right now, it would just perk me right back up. And sure shit, it did.
Yeah.
But I don't. You know, I have this amazing bed. My wife and I, one of the things we invested in was a king-size bed. It's a Tempur-Pedic.
Yeah.
Great sheets. Looks amazing. It just looks good. When you walk in, you see the bed, you're like, that's a bed.
Adults live here.
I want to sleep in that bed.
Yeah.
I'm going to exist in that bed. And when my wife doesn't have to leave really early, she leaves super early for work. When she gets to sleep in sometimes, I will look over at my clock and it'll be 8:30 and the alarm will go off and then she'll still be there and I'll just turn that off and roll over and just kind of like just a slow snuggle. Just so she can't really realize that I'm doing it. You know, just because she doesn't like being that close to me sometimes in the morning. I freak her out a little bit. She's like, what are you doing? So I'll just slowly snuggle in, test it. And if she doesn't wake up, if the beast doesn't wake up, you know, if the dragon doesn't look over at me, and I just kind of settle into it and fall asleep. Until inevitably, 20 minutes later, she's like, what are you? Get off me.
So you're talking about position one.
Yeah.
That's position one. Yeah. Hardcore.
I got to go. I go right into position one.
Yeah.
You want position one? We're doing it right now.
I'll take it right now.
There's no second or third step. Position one is the step.
Okay. I'll take it.
I'll take
whatever position you got for me.
Yeah.
Position three is a good step too.
I like sleeping in the mornings. That's one of the things my wife has learned about me. She lets me do that. If you let me sleep in till like 9 o'clock or 9:30-ish, I'm good for the rest of the day for whatever needs to happen. Mm-hmm. I'll run errands all day. I'll go to the mall. I'll go shopping. I'll work out with you. I'll go for a walk. I'll go to yoga. It doesn't matter. I'll do my taxes. I'll do all that shit. Just let me sleep in the morning. If you don't, I have to do that, and I have to get Starbucks and some food in me, and then I'll be good for the rest of the day. But if you don't, if either of those things don't happen, then I am a snippy bitch.
Nick.
Yes.
What's your topic?
My topic comes from Patreon today.
Oh, does it?
Yes, from an old friend on Patreon. And, of course, my phone has just gone completely white right now. Because, sorry, one second.
You need to get with that iPhone 6.
Yeah. Shahar.
Hey, Shahar.
Asks,
thanks for your support on patreon.com/kindoffunny.
What are the age-old questions? Something I've often wondered about you gentlemen. I know Colin specifically because I've roomed with him now. And I've seen parts of his body that I don't even think he's seen, truth be told. Parts that
possible.
Are soft and curvaceous. Shahar says, what is the best type of underwear? Boxers, briefs, brief boxers, Superman undies, commando. Please discuss. And if Nick wants to show us his underwear, I wouldn't mind.
Nick.
Oh, this is fun. So I have one set of underwear that's the Christmas tree.
Yeah.
It's like the Christmas theme underwear that I'm like, oh, I got to get that out of the way first. I got E3 next week and I can't wear Christmas.
Got it.
Holiday underwear.
I can't die at E3 and have people here spread the rumor
about Christmas underwear. You know, so I'm wearing the Christmas tree underwear.
Let's see them.
They're like,
oh, that's cute. Yeah, I don't know. Okay.
But boxers. Like
they're boxers.
They're regular old boxers.
So I'm segueing over to the boxer brief.
Yeah, you are. That's the future.
Because it's a little bit more
perfect.
No, yeah, it's the perfect
you
underwear.
You just feel more secure, I think. But for the most part, I've always been a boxer guy. Because growing up in Southern California, it's really hot. And you don't want anything on you. You start getting like that layer of sweat. I don't need that. You get like random like markings on you when you gotta take them off. No, thank you. I like the boxer. But you know, like if they're too tight, they pinch your leg.
Yeah, I mean, just go a size up, man. Like,
no, I'm gonna go. But then it defeats the purpose. Then I've got too much material down there. And if you're wearing the skinny jeans, you know, you got the same problem.
That's the problem with boxers.
That's the problem.
The bunching. I ain't down with that at all.
So I've been wearing boxers for a long time, but I started doing yoga with my wife on a pretty regular basis, with the exception of the last couple of weeks, because the live show pretty much killed me and I haven't recovered since. And now we're going straight into E3 and Comic-Con.
You'll be fine.
But what was cool about it is when you do yoga, you're all upside down and all sorts of crazy stuff. So if you're wearing boxers, chances are you're going to show the yoga instructor your ball sack.
Yeah.
Which I'm okay with personally. I don't really care. I think I have a lovely set of balls.
Yeah.
So it's Colin. Thank you. Jury's still out on Greg. I haven't seen his yet, but I don't want to room with him because he snores like a fucking grizzly bear.
He snores. That's the, you're making up stories about me. Is that what?
So I started wearing these Lululemon like boxer, like they're like boxer briefs. I don't know. They have some sort of like ball catching name for them. I don't know what they're called.
A ball catching name.
But the reason I like them,
Lululemon ball catchers.
It's like they're like I forget what they call them. It's something like.
I love that you wear Lululemon, bro. This is so funny.
I got three pairs of Lululemon underwear that I wear to yoga specifically. But the reason I like wearing yoga is when I do yoga a lot, your quads get big and muscular, and they remind me of George St. Pierre's quads, who used to fight formerly the UFC, and he used to wear the same sort of underwear tight. Short when he fought, and he always looked really cool. So in my brain, right before I go to yoga, before I put my clothes on, I throw on those Lululemon boxer briefs. They're hella tight, and I look at myself, and I throw a kick, and hopefully I didn't hurt myself, and then I put the rest of my clothes on, and I go, namaste.
Namaste. Yeah, I wear boxer briefs. I used to be a boxers guy, like I think most people were. And it seemed like that was like the thing growing up, right? Yeah. You went from the whitey tighty-whities. Boxers.
And those were cool.
And now I've gotten to the boxer briefs. Yeah, boxers were fine, but they were, but that was in the baggy jean era.
It's a different thing, man.
Yeah,
Marky Mark popularized them.
Mark Wahlberg. And now I'm in the boxer brief thing. I wear the Michael Kors. That's where I got started with
you. Couldn't get Michael Kors if you were fucking Michael Kors, Greg. That was a Nicki Minaj quote.
Sorry, I couldn't get keep that. My bad.
Yeah.
Well, who is she insulting?
Huh?
What is anyways, that?
Just women in general.
Okay.
But she wouldn't insult women because she's, you know, empowering towards women. But just the women that aren't on her level. The basic bitches, if you will. She is a bad bitch.
Yeah, she's a bad bitch.
They're soft. I like that. They're snug on the leg, which I like. And then there's plenty of room for all the ghibli bits to move around. But they're also, they don't have too much room. They're not just out there in the wind doing
their thing. They have their space. It's like a nice little sack for the sack, you know? I'm happy about that. I've said this before, and I'll say it a goddamn again. Boxer briefs are the male equivalent to yoga pants. You get the yoga pants on, and that's when you know that you're good. You're ready to look good if you're wearing yoga pants. You're ready to look good if you're wearing fucking boxer briefs.
Good point.
You just have this different level of confidence. Like, you just feel better about yourself. You're just like, check out the, what do you call them, the ghibli bits?
Yeah.
I like that, you know?
I'll start calling them the peaches and cream.
I mean, that's whatever you want to call them, little, like... Peach LaRue or whatever the hell it was. But they just make you feel good, and they present things nicely too.
They do present nicely. Because
they're kind of just like, hey.
Well, look, see, that's what I like about it, is because they suck everything in, and then they let the right part have a little bit of space.
Yeah.
So it's almost like every part of your lower like body, from that like mid quad to waistline, is pushing toward your dick and pushing your dick outwards so it can be the noble peacock that you've always wanted it to be.
When we did the last time in LA, when I went down, I did lip sync battle again. At the end, I put on a dress and went out there and did a Time of My Life with Elliot Morgan. And we filmed an entire run of it. And at the end, the producer was like, that was great. We need to do it again. And Greg, you need to go put on shorts. We can see the outline of your dick. And it was a good outline of my dick. It wasn't that my dick looked bad. My dick was presentable for the entire audience. I know, me too.
Because
and
that's usually,
tiny dick, baby dick.
You have a little baby dick.
Tootsie Roll dick.
And what's so funny is that you have to go online to buy condoms that are specifically made for your little dick.
The tiniest condoms possible. I have to go find.
It's unbelievable.
Colin does me a favor all the time, reminds me, leaves notes about the tiny condoms all over the house. It's great. I would forget about them. But this time, they were saying your dick's too big. You got to put on shorts. And I credit that.
They didn't, just to let you know, they didn't say it was too big, Greg.
Sure.
They just said it was noticeable.
It was too noticeable. Yeah.
No one said, because Greg's dick is about the size. Think of a latex glove. Yeah. Think about the pinky in a latex glove. Yeah, then cut that in half.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. That's about how big Greg's dick is.
So it's basically just the head of like a 12-year-old penis.
Yeah, basically.
Okay.
The head, the Greg's penis, the head on Greg's penis is like a little thimble.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's about a quarter of an inch of shaft. But then his balls are enormous. And that's what's so mysterious. And sometimes his dick actually gets stuck somewhere in his balls. Like it goes down.
It's like one of those, inside, like, those little inside. Mushrooms.
Don't ask me how I know.
You ever seen those adorable little mushrooms?
That's what it sounds like. Is that what they're called? Chantrell mushrooms?
Sure, chantrell mushrooms.
Or the shiitake. I like the shiitake.
Shiitake mushrooms are big, though, aren't they?
No, they're long and like,
oh, right,
thin.
Right, right.
Like this big.
Mushrooms
like
are cool. Mushrooms. We should do a topic about mushrooms sometime.
Oh, I love mushrooms.
Yeah.
But I don't mean that in a drug addict way. Okay, guys? I mean that
I'll
like mushrooms.
I'll let the internet interpret that however they want.
I like boxers. I've always liked boxers. I went to the briefs for a little while, and I ran into – it was a conundrum because I ran into a litany of problems.
Mm-hmm.
My thighs are bigger than a normal person's thighs for my size mm-hmm. because of all the hockey I played. They're just huge. They're huge. And they're always going to be that. And they're always going to be big.
They're like two Thanksgiving Day turkeys.
So there's a lot of like rubbing kind of going
yeah.
on.
Yeah.
And what I found was that the fabric was going up and into the ball area, mm-hmm. like – covering the grundle in such mm-hmm. a way that I would constantly have to pick it out and stuff like that. Yeah. It was just the way my body was built. So I went back to boxers and it worked fine. Now I don't, you know, there's a few problems here. Balls, are they getting a little more hangy? Sure they are. Absolutely.
They get longer.
Gravity
as you get older.
Is relentless.
Yeah.
Is it going to get to the point where they're knocking, you know, like those things you have on your desk where you have one ball and you're not, and it's just, will that be my balls between my kneecaps at one point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
probably.
Probably.
But the thing that's most important is, am I comfortable going through my day in the boxers? And the answer is yes, because A, I really don't give a fuck how I look. And B, I'm going to keep repping the boxers till I die because it makes me feel young. The third thing is that I wish I could go commando, but I have a fear, and I would absolutely go commando if I was confident that I always would zip my zipper up.
But there's no confidence there.
No.
It will happen, and you will never forget it.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever done that before?
Yes.
Oh, my God. It was the worst. It was the worst, too. And we were getting ready. This is with a past girlfriend. We were getting ready to have sex, too. And I went and peed, and then I was like, I was just in the bathroom, like on the line. Come on, like, we are not about to get intimate at all. Right. I am off. I got
my baby dick stuck in my zipper.
I'm on injury reserve. If you guys take me to the hospital, I've amputated my baby dick.
Speaking of just commando and stuff like that, I used to love for years sleeping naked. Mm. And I haven't done that in some time, but I was a big fan for quite a while.
Well, we did
sleeping butt naked. Oh, that was different, though.
You're on vacation.
Did I tell you that one night Nick came in and I was in his bed because I thought it would be funny?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, post-coital doesn't count as sleeping naked, you know?
Mm-hmm.
We had some laughs, though, didn't we?
We had great. We giggled like school.
Wait, now I want to go back to that. So post-coital doesn't count as sleeping naked.
Yeah,
but it does. But no, if you fall asleep naked, does that count or no? You're just talking about cuddling or what are you talking about?
No, like if you're naked after a sexual act, like that's just...
And you fall asleep?
Yeah, that just happens to be... That doesn't count as sleeping naked.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Sleeping
with you.
Naked, you need to go into it. Like at that point, you're sleeping in all this goo and this ooze.
That's the gross thing is that stuff. After sex, I feel the need to put on clothes pretty quickly because I'm like, there's so much... There's a lot of slippy slide kind of things going
on
here.
I like getting it into all my like pores and stuff.
Tim likes to just go down, like just scrunch down into the fetal position and try to find whatever's wet down there and just put his face on
it. To me, it's like, I'm not sure, is this me? Is this wetness from me? Is this moistness from some other source? I need a barrier after that
mm-hmm.
to be put up. And that barrier is usually a pair of boxers. Mm-hmm. Where I'm like, I feel safe mm-hmm. and secure mm-hmm. and snug mm-hmm. now again, in my, you know, with myself. So I typically don't sleep naked with someone else. I sleep naked by myself, sprawl the fuck out of my bed mm-hmm. naked. You better believe it.
Yeah.
But
see, I even in non-sexual experiences and scenarios, I feel like I naturally create liquids. Just a nice little like layer of moisture coming through. Yeah, a little Coke seeping through.
Yeah.
In all my grundly areas.
That's not what that brown liquid is.
You know? What's up? It's not so much brown liquid.
I know.
I ain't making the poops, but it's just like, you know, butt sweats and stuff. I feel like I get a lot of butt sweat. I get a lot of like, you know, Gucci area,
yeah.
like just excretions. And it's like, if I'm laying there, it's like, I don't want to be like getting that everywhere for everyone else. Like, I'm just like.
You're polite.
Yeah. You know,
you were raised better than that.
Mm-hmm. I usually take showers before I go to bed because I'm crazy about that kind of thing. What's worse than a sweaty ass, really?
Nothing.
When you're walking and it's hot and there's a drip going down your back and then it goes directly into your ass crack.
Well, the only thing worse than that
you know
is
what I'm talking
boxer.
About.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Boxer brunching, man.
There's nothing you can do about it. Yeah,
I hate it. Boxer brunching is just like, it's a damn epidemic. We need to stop it. we should do something about this. Now, going, yeah, when they all bunch up and stuff.
I have some moves to alleviate that I can teach you guys.
Well, yeah, you do the whole stuff, but it's like everyone knows what you're doing.
You gotta, yeah, but you gotta do the whole, like.
Yeah.
You know, I do that in the bathroom all the time. You know, you're doing the tires at fucking mini camp.
You know what I mean? Out there running the combine.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing with boxer briefs, though, is depending on where you buy them, there's different lengths. Some are closer to just briefs, but I don't like going that close. But there's certain places, H&M, they have a really nice set that don't really have that long of the leg area.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like they're very close to briefs. Is there a difference between boxer briefs and brief boxers?
It's like red, orange, and orange, red.
No, there's a boxer brief, and then there's another one that's... There's like three groups of that specific type of underwear. We'll have to look it up. But like, and that's... I made that mistake last time I went to buy the Lululemon ones, because the ones I bought were like really short.
Uh-huh.
So they were basically tighty whities, but with a little bit
Right now I'm rocking some of those from H&M.
Those are good. Fine, but I like the ones that are a little bit longer, especially when I do yoga, because if I'm upside down, I like if the pants come down. Yeah. You don't want to see those my pasty white thighs. I'm not trying to show people that. I'm not trying to expose people to that horror. Also, your quads just look dope when they're covered in latex. Or like spandex,
that's the
rather.
Thing, man.
Not latex.
Oh, you nearly outed yourself as a latex salesman. You want to be my latex salesman.
No, I do. I do. Yeah, we got to look those up. But yeah. So you're both boxer briefs, and both boxers.
Are you unzipping your pants?
Kevin, where do you come in on this?
He just unzipped his pants completely.
Boxer briefs?
Good for him, man. I mean, Live it out, Tim. Out loud. Mm-hmm. Bravo. Right.
Bravo. Thank you. I was hoping your phone could be bigger than that. Your phone is just really tiny.
Yeah, actually, it's looking smaller these days. Did you get a new one that's smaller than the other one?
His hands are getting bigger.
Wait. Okay, Google. Text Tim.
That's not how it works.
Send message. Thank you.
You have to turn it on first.
Okay, Google.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, so you turn your arm like that. That's unnecessary. I don't like that.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's another episode of the Game Over Greggy Show. Thank you for joining us. Remember, each and every week, 4, sometimes 5 best friends gather on this table. Each bring a random topic discussion for your amusement. If you like that, you can get the whole show early over on patreon.com/kindoffunny each and every Friday. But if you don't have any money to throw our way, no big deal. You can go to youtube.com/kindoffunny, get the show broken up topic by topic, day by day, until we post the entire thing the following Friday as an MP3 in YouTube video. Gentlemen.
Yes.
Thank you for this. We now must begin breaking all of this down and mailing it to E3.
Break it down.
You're all writing funny stuff here? What do we got here? You got a fuck your mouth. And then a Colin's signature and fuck your mouth. Is that your signature, Colin?
Yeah, with my left hand.
With your left hand? We're having a good time over here.
Is that your notebook?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Until next time.
Also my pen.
It's been our pleasure to serve you.